low and really, really gay. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the show. Sorry about that. I'm having a little bit of an issue. Hold on. I didn't get myself prepared before I started. Just a second. Okay. There we go. Let me get comfortable here. So welcome to the show. Thanks for joining me today on Brain Purge. It is Thursday, 11:45 p.m. here in Dallas, Texas. So I hope you're having a great night wherever you are, or day if you're listening in the archives. Or whatever day you're listening on these. Just so you know, you can always check me out at offlimitsshow.com. You can find the latest episodes, all the episodes from this year, as well as all the other episodes, all 300 plus episodes. You can go to Spreaker.com and find those as well. And Twitter and Facebook, of course. And speaking of Facebook, I said on my last show, I think, that I was going to delete my Facebook page, the Donovan Icon page, which is a... not the off-limits show page itself, but just the page that I use for the identity. Because I wanted to use my personal page and then use just the off-limits show page for the show. But I realized that if I did that, I wouldn't be able to, first of all, chat with people unless it's through my personal Facebook page. And also, I wouldn't be able to post the way I usually do and kind of be involved in discussions about things as the off-limits show, because it limits you. If you just have a page, you can't really actually interact. You just, all you can do is do stuff on your page, but you can't actually post stuff on other people's pages as the page. So since that was the case, I decided to keep the page because that, I just got tired of having to monitor two things all the time, the off-limits show webpage, and then also the my Donovan Icon page. Sorry. So, that's why I was going to do that, but I decided not to. So everything's good. Just letting you know. So it's Brain Purge. You know what that means? I just say whatever the hell I want to say. So we're talking about whatever it comes to mind. The first thing that comes to mind is, recently saw, or I think it was last night or this morning, this article, I'm sure you've heard about it, about, James Franco, hitting on some 17-year-old girl. So I read the whole article, and what she had done is she had actually posted pictures that he had sent her from her iPhone, actually the text messages he sent her, as well as pictures he sent her of himself at that moment, as well as proof that she asked him to send to prove that it was him. So the first thing he did is he proved, first of all, they were chatting, whatever. Well, first of all, what happened? Let me go back. First, what happened is she saw him out at some event in New York City, and she was staying there visiting. She's from Sweden or from some other country. I can't remember what country, England or Ireland, I think. And she saw him in the crowd, and he saw her, and you know, she was just one of the many, many fans wanting an autograph. And so he reached over to her and said, he signed her page, and he said, are you on Instagram? And she said, yeah. He said, tag me. She said, you want me to tag you? He said, yeah, tag me. And she said, okay. And so he gave her a smile, and he walked away and kept going. And so apparently she did tag him, and then he tagged her back or whatever. And they started talking on, either Instagram or text, I think texting, text messages. And, when they were talking, he basically said, where are you staying? Are you staying in a hotel? Do you want to come over? Do you want me to, you know, come over there? Blah, blah, blah. And he said, you can come over right now. Where are you? Or I'll come over there. He was like really anxious to see her. And he knew who she was because he saw her in the crowd and he remembered her also from her pictures on Instagram. And so she said, come over for what? And I don't know, if something sexual. He had some sexual innuendo. And then he sent a picture. She said, how do I know this is really James Franco? And she said, send me a picture of yourself to make sure it's really you. And so he sent a picture of himself at that moment to prove that it really was him that she was talking to. And she said, wow, it really is you, or something like that. And I'm just trying to see if I could find the thing. I had it earlier up here. He asked her about her birthday. Do you have a boyfriend? When is your birthday? And she said she said she was nearly 18, my mom, and not if you're around, when he asked what she's doing for birthday, where she's going to be with or whatever. And anyway, so he kept going on and on and on. And he said, I'll meet you if you write, she said, I'll meet you if you write my name on a piece of paper, then send it to me with your face also in the picture, please. And so he sent her back a picture of himself with her name written on a piece of paper, Lucy, on the paper. And he said, don't tell anybody. And she said, oh, I won't tell anybody. And of course she did. She told everybody. And so she turned him down and said, oh, I'm sorry, I have to go. Maybe next time in New York when I'm 18 years old or something like that. So everybody's going down on him, or not going down on him, but getting kind of calling him a perv because he is trying to go after the 17-year-old girl. Now, first of all, he's like my age, right? Or a little younger. He's probably like 33 or 34 or something, I think. And he is much older than she is. Yes. Okay. But she is of the age of consent. So in the city of New York, or most places in the United States, even 17 is the age of consent. In Texas, it is as well. So I guess technically it's not illegal for him to pursue someone that age. But it's kind of creepy, I guess, because she's basically a kid and he's, you know, a man, a famous man. But I don't think it's like, I think it's a little creepy for that reason, but I also don't think it's wrong because it's like, you know, he's an adult, she's age of consent, so what? So I don't know. I know when I was 17 years old, I was having sex with guys his age, so I don't see what the big deal is. People are so hung up on age and everything. And now obviously if it's like, come here, little girl, and they're going to molest you, or it's not consensual, that's obviously a different story and something that is not what I'm just talking about here. But if it's something that's, you know, you're an adult or the age of consent and you are making the choice to have sex with somebody or that's much older than you, that's your decision. And, you know, that's why it's the age of consent, because you are now of age of consent. So there's nothing wrong with it legally, I don't think. I think maybe ethically there is, but I don't know. I wouldn't have a problem with it. Trust me, if I were a 17-year-old guy and he were into guys and he'd asked me to come to his hotel, I would have been over there in a second, because trust me, because I think he's very sexy and interesting and unique, but that's just me. But anyway, so people have been coming down on him hard about that. And he actually said in a tweet, he said, I hope parents keep their teens away from me. Thank you. And so I don't know how he's taking it or what he's going to do about it or how people are going to spin it, the story about this, but I don't think it's a big deal. I don't think people should make a big deal out of it. It's not like she was 14 years old and just some little girly fan and he's trying to have sex with a little kid, you know. But that's just my opinion. So you may disagree with me, but, you know, whatever. It's my show. So anyway, that's that. Also, I wanted to talk about the fact that the Mozilla guy, you know, the guy I talked about on the show the other night, he is the CEO, or was the CEO rather, of Mozilla, which produces Firefox. And it had come out that he'd given political contributions in 2008 to organizations in his support of opposing same-sex marriage. And of course, when this came out, he was branded a big homophobe and a bigot. And as a result of that, people boycotted, including OkCupid, the website, from using their browser. They wouldn't allow anyone to use the Netscape. I'm sorry, the Netscape. That's how old I am. The Firefox browser, used to be called Netscape. The Firefox browser on OkCupid's site, because OkCupid was protesting their homophobia and their anti-gay bigotry. And so many other people began to follow suit, and it was a huge backlash. And so now he has stepped down as of yesterday. because of the backlash as a result of his stance on gay rights. And the good thing is that Mozilla as a company, the thing that was the big deal is that Mozilla as a company was very much against him and for gay rights. It was just him at the helm, the CEO, who was against gay marriage and gay rights, etc. So, you know, he really wasn't representative of the company's culture. So I'm not really sure why he became, I guess because he was the inventor. I think I read that he invented Mozilla, the engine that drives Netscape and that drove Netscape and drives Firefox. So I think that's why he got the job or whatever. But, you know, I think if your personal beliefs are somehow opposed to the company culture, I don't really see how you can lead the company in the right direction. It doesn't make any sense to me. So it makes sense to me that they got rid of him and or made him step down, because he certainly should have. And, you know, I've worked for corporations before in the past when I was, you know, I've worked for myself since 2000, okay? I've worked for myself for a very long time. I know a long time ago I worked for a company that was actually very, very conservative, highly conservative. And I was the only, like, liberal there. I'm gay, obviously, and I'm very openly open about my feelings and thoughts. As you know, I'm very outspoken. And so it was very difficult for me to be in that company culture. And I just felt very uncomfortable, although I got paid really well. And I liked my job itself. I didn't like the people I worked with or for. So it was really kind of miserable every day in a lot of ways. So I think that, you know, if you're part of a company in which your personal beliefs or who you are somehow is opposed to the company's culture, then you don't belong there. And no paycheck or anything is really worth squelching your own sense of self and your own personality just to make you know, someone else more comfortable. And I've never, you know, and there's a saying I've used many times before, you know, never dim your light for someone else, or, you know, whatever. And actually, even Lady Gaga has a song. She says something about, I can't remember what song it is. I think it's Paper Gangsta, I think, is a song from her first album. And she says, she said she's not going to dim her light for some guy or something like that. So, but I have always believed that. And I think people should always just be themselves regardless of what other people think, because ultimately you're left with yourself anyway. And, you know, you are essentially a unique individual, whomever you are. In some way, your beliefs are specific to you and who you are. And why you believe that way is because of how you were raised or where you were raised or your experiences, you know. Those things make up who we are as human beings, our past. And so to deny that and to say, you know, I'm going to dim my light or squelch myself or make myself smaller so that everyone else around me is comfortable or more comfortable is a travesty and is really completely against your own self interest and is not honoring who you yourself are. So whatever it may be, whether it's just you in a job or you at school or you among your family or friends or whatever, or strangers even, you know, if you could always manage to be yourself regardless of where you are, then you are so far ahead of the game of life, because ultimately you're going to learn that lesson anyway as you get older. Those of you who are young out there listening, so I think that you're going to learn that lesson anyway. You might as well just do it now, because your life will be much better off as it is now, instead of waiting till you're old to figure that out. And that reminds me, when I come back, I'll talk about this, but I'm going to talk about, when I come back in a second after this song, I'm going to talk about how, you know, when we're young, we think we know everything. A lot of us do. I know I did. I don't think I knew everything, but, you know, most people who are young just think you can't tell them anything. And so I'm going to talk about that and talk about a little bit of what I've learned as I've gotten older. I'll be right back. You're just a damn old bitch. I don't believe any word you say. You're just a damn old bitch, and I don't believe any word you say.
jail, oh bitch.
All right, so we're back. So before the break, I was talking about, you know, as you age and trying to get yourself on track, you know, and in tune with who you are as a human being. And I think it's very important to do that because I know when I was young, as most people, when we were young, we are insecure, we are self-conscious. We don't know who we are yet because we haven't been living that long. I mean, especially as an adult. I mean, you know, as a kid, we begin to come into our own around the age of 6 in terms of who our personality is going to develop to be. They say your personality is what it's going to be for the rest of your life, for the most part, by the time you're 6 years old. It's set. And so the things you've learned through your parents and behaviors and how to interact with other human beings and or how not to is kind of set in stone at that point. And so although you may change in some minor ways, generally we're the same. And so that's kind of disappointing because I think, I don't think it's necessarily the truth. I think that, yes, I think for the most part, most of us do stay the same, but I don't think that we are set in stone, meaning I think we're malleable and we are capable of changing ourselves and learning. And for God's sake, that's what life's about, is learning about ourselves and everything around us. And so I think when we're, you know, as we age and stuff and we begin to get into our own self and, you know, we're teenagers, we really begin to have an identity. And then by the time we're in our early 20s, I think it's pretty much set who we're going to be as a person and what direction in life we're going to choose. Although I don't think you have to have it by then or no. I just think that most people have some idea about who they are. But it isn't until you're like your 30s, I say, until you really know who you are and really begin to understand yourself. And now my late 30s, I'll be 39 in June. I know now that I really have a real, I mean, I have 100% sense of self. I know exactly who I am. I know exactly what I think about everything and exactly what I want to do with my life. I know exactly where I want to be in the future. I know exactly what I want my life to mean and the meaning I want it to have. I know exactly who I am and exactly what I am capable of. I know how strong I am. I know how incredibly talented I am in many ways and how good I am at my career. And I know all wonderful things about myself. I know these things to be true because I've lived long enough to see the proof of them through my career and through other people commending me on being these ways and other people in my life and around me saying that, yes, this is who you are, kind of confirming who I think I am. So I know who I am now. However, as I was saying, when you're young, you don't really know. And so what I was trying to get at to earlier was that, you know, I have nieces and nephews through my husband. I don't have any brothers and sisters. So they're my nieces and nephews through my husband, you know, his family. And they call me uncle. One of them calls me Uncle Donovan or whatever. But some of them just call me Donovan. But they consider me like an uncle, you know, and I consider them like nephews and nieces. And they are, you know, they've made mistakes and that I wish they would have listened to me about. And I don't expect them to listen to me. I'm just their uncle's husband, right? But I tried and I tried to direct them and lead them in the right direction by telling them through my own sense of knowledge throughout my life that I've gained and garnered being older than they are, twice the age they are in some instances or more. I know what the fuck I'm talking about. And so I know when I was young, especially in my teens, but also in my early 20s, I think, you know, you don't listen to your parents, you don't listen to your elders or whatever, you don't listen to people older than you necessarily. You don't really understand the value of what someone older than you has to share. And, you know, I was the same way to some degree. It's not that I didn't care. I did listen to my grandmother and the story she told. I did listen to my mom. I listened to my family members, but half the time I didn't agree with them. And most of the time, I'm the kind of person who has to learn my mistakes by making them. You can tell me something till I'm blue in the face, but I have to make the mistake myself to truly know or learn it. That's just the way I am. I have to learn everything the hard way, basically. That's how my whole life has been. So if I don't, you can tell me to do something. And so there's a lot of people like that. And my nieces and nephews may be the same way, that I can tell them until I'm blue in the face, don't do this, don't do that, da, 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 da. For example, I have a niece whom I adore, and she is 18 years old, or 19 almost, or 19 now, actually. And she, or she's about to be 19. Anyway, yeah. And she's a freshman in college, and she was pursuing something that she really didn't love because that's what she was told she should be doing or whatever. And I told her, you know, I don't want to go against what your family's telling you to do, but I think that you should do whatever makes you happy, because ultimately you're going to end up doing it anyway, and you're just going to waste time on something you don't want to do. And they were trying to help her find something that was more stable and something that was going to keep her, you know, financially secure, which was nursing. But she didn't really like it or love it and didn't do that well at it. However, she did really incredibly well at all of her psychology classes. She loved psychology. She loved it. She got it. She understood it. It was second nature to her, and she did really well in all of her courses. And so I said, well, she said, I want to be a psychologist. I said, well, be a psychologist then. You know, you need to do what you want to do, because it's your life to live, not your mother's or your father's or your family or anybody else's. It's your life to live. And she ultimately ended up switching. I'm not saying because of me, but I'm just saying that she did. And I'm glad she may have taken some of my advice and thought about that and understood that maybe I know what I'm talking about, because I know it's true. But also, and on the other hand, she doesn't take my advice on other things. Like, for example, I said, do not get pregnant before you graduate. Don't get married until you're 30. Don't get hung up on some guy. And of course, she's dating some guy she's hung up on, and she's traveling all over the country to see him. He just enlisted in the military, and he's in the base in Chicago right now. And she's going up there to see him and everything else. And I have no problem with him. I've met him, and he's all right, I guess. But she has sort of been all consumed by him. And so I said, you know, your grade's okay. And so now her grades are okay. And before they weren't. Because she was focused on him. And I told her, I said, look, you've got to focus on school. This, you're going to ruin this opportunity, and you're going to end up having to repeat school or do something else later in life. Because if you don't have your fucking college degree, you don't have anything, trust me, in this world. You've got to have, I mean, these days, in my opinion, a college degree is like almost like a high school diploma. If you just have your first bachelor's degree, it's almost like a high school diploma, because it's like you can barely do anything with just a high school diploma these days. If you want to have an actual career and a life that actually means something financially, it's really hard to come up in this world without an actual college degree. And if you have a master's degree, that's even better. And if you have a doctorate degree, well, it's even better. And so you're not guaranteed money. You're not guaranteed a career. You're not guaranteed anything, but you are our job or whatever. But it's far more likely you're going to do better with those things than without them, especially. So my point is like, I tell people all the time what they should do, what they shouldn't do. Oh, and yeah, like I said, don't get married till you're 30. I think that's very good advice to anybody, whether you're gay or straight or whatever, because, and people always, you know, I'm sure they think I'm, you know, people who are in their 20s are going to think I'm stupid for saying this, or I don't know what I'm talking about. But I know in my 20s, that I, you know, dated all kinds of guys in my 20s and my teen years as well. And it kind of helped me figure out who I was compatible with and who I wasn't, and who I really, and also, as I said, you don't really know yourself that well until your 30s, in my opinion. It's not until your 30s that you really kind of begin to know who you are. So if you don't know who you are yet, how can you really know who's right for you? You know what I mean? Even if you think you know who you are in your 20s, you don't. If you're with somebody, like my niece, for example, and you're wanting to get married, I say wait until you're 30. Both of you are 30. If both of you are in the same age range, if you're different ages, wait till you're at least you're 30 and he's over 30 or she's over 30. So just wait until then, because if you're going to be together, it doesn't matter if you're actually married or not. It doesn't matter if you're married. It doesn't matter if you're not married. And the commitment to be married will mean so much more, I think, in a lot of ways, if you do that when you're older, wiser, you both know exactly what you want, which it is each other, and you want to have a life with one another, and you know that for sure. And there's no grass is greener on the other side type mentality or possibilities or whatever. You already know who you want. And so if you are going to get married, then what the fucking difference does it make if you wait a few years? So that's what I've always told her. That's what I've told other people. But now no one ever listens to me, but they should, because I know love is a powerful thing and you're intoxicated. It's intoxicating. It's something that it's difficult to kind of overcome the pull of that love has and the kind of fog it puts you in. But that's just it. When you are in love with someone, you're in a fog, especially in the earliest years of a relationship. I'd say the first 2 years of a relationship, and this is by experience and also by psychology books and things I read. But the first 2 years of a relationship, you're in the romantic phase and you are living in a fog because you don't see the person as they are. You see them as you've projected them to be. That's what everybody does. We all do that. We project upon the person these incredible qualities about who they are. Like, you know, oh my God, he said this, he said that or whatever. And the things that annoy us slightly, we think are cute, or the things that, you know, we don't think they're anything big deal. And it's not until a couple of years later when that wears off, which actually the oxytocin in your body dissipates, which is what makes us fall in love with people. That begins to fall away and subside for the most part. And the sexual attraction is still there, but it's not as strong as it was because you're not like, you know, no one maintains the sexual attraction you feel at the very beginning of a relationship. It doesn't happen. Nobody, I don't care who you are. I mean, you can keep it alive by doing things, you know, to keep it spicy and fun. Yes. But I'm saying you still have sex and stuff, but that same type of attraction usually does not, it usually fades. Okay. To some degree. And not, it's not a bad thing because you still are attracted to each other. You still have sex, whatever, but you're not focused on, you know, sex. You're focused on building a life together and having kids or careers or whatever as well. And that's just a part of your relationship, not every part of it. And not the biggest part of it, as it typically is when we first meet someone. It's all hot and heavy. Trust me, that's how it is. I know. So my point is that because that fades after the first couple of years, in 2 years, if you're still with somebody that you projected them to be someone they weren't, and you figure out, oh, this person isn't really who I thought they were, and you're not okay with that, then you're stuck with them if you're married. If there's someone that you thought that they, if you're someone, there's someone else other than who you thought they were, you're stuck with somebody that you didn't really know. And so I always advocate, whatever your age you are, be together for at least 2 years and don't get married until you've been together for three. That's my personal opinion and my advice. And I think it's good because I know if I'd married guys I'd met in the past that I'd been with for a year or so, without, you know, knowing what I was doing, I would have regretted it because there are guys in my past that if I'd stayed, you know, I'd end up breaking up with them later or vice versa because we weren't compatible after the whole flush of love faded away. Or sex or whatever was attracting us to one another. So that's my advice for that. Okay, so I'm going to come back, talk about some more stuff in the news, and we'll be right back. So that's Bad Romance by Lady Gaga. Good song. You know, I miss that Lady Gaga from her first two albums. She was such a love her music from that time. The last album she had sucked. So art pop, I don't know. I liked GUI. That's a good song. And of course, Applause, but that's pretty much it. So hoping her next album will be better. Speaking of albums, Madonna's coming out with a new album supposedly this year. We'll see if it's this year or early next year. Typically, she releases her song, her albums in the beginning of the fall of New Year's, but we'll see if it comes out this year. But I can't wait for that. So hopefully it'll be better than her last two albums, because it really is... sorry, I got distracted by something. Really can't wait. Anyway, because you know I love my Madonna. Anyway, so Mississippi passed a religious freedom bill on Tuesday, very similar to the one that was passed in Arizona. But Jan Brewer in Arizona, the governor, vetoed that one because of protests by gay rights groups, civil liberties groups, et cetera. And the Mississippi version was actually thought that it was going to be done for because two earlier versions had missed their deadlines. But they resurrected it recently or last week, and that committee that resurrected it stripped it out of some of the language that was being objected to. And so now it's going to be, they're saying it's going to pass or to pass or whatever. And the two sides are trying to, I guess they're going to, the governor's going to have to decide whether he wants to sign it or not into legislation. But it always surprises me how people want to put hatred or bigotry into a constitution. Now they're saying it's a religious freedom bill. They're saying that they have the right to it bars the government discrimination against religious exercise, meaning that they can say anything they want about gay people or black people or Hispanic people or women or whatever, even if it's sexist or misogynistic or racist or homophobic. They can still say these things if it's under the protection or under the guise of their religion. Now, you all know how I feel about religion anyway. And so this just pisses me off. And I think it's really just, it's stupid. First of all, it's not going to happen. I mean, it may happen. It may be passed, but it's not going to stay even if it does, because it's obviously against the federal constitution. The federal constitution always outweighs any other state constitution. So if something in the state constitution is not in line with the federal constitution, then it cannot be law in that state. That's the way it is here in the United States of America, and that's for good reason. So that's good. They're also trying to put into the United States Constitution, though. There's a group of people trying to put into the United States Constitution that we will not be able to have gay... I can't remember. Gay marriage. It's trying to get a law onto the books or to the Supreme Court that would state that gay marriage is illegal. So they're trying to go all the way to the federal government to do this. And the federal government's already ruled that it's a right to be able to marry whomever you want. And it was done during Loving versus Virginia. And it's been done again in terms of the gay people here in the United States in order to marry whom we want at a federal level. So you can't put into the Constitution anything that's already been ruled on, unless it's for some reason there's real reason to rule on it again. And it's really, really rare, really, really hard to do, because it's really not something they typically overturn, especially so soon. So they can try all they want, but it's not going to do anything. It's not going to happen. It's not going to matter. Fortunately, we live in a country where we have more freedom than a lot of the countries do in some ways. And we have this certain kind of law and constitutional law that affords us certain rights that are inalienable. And so you can fight it all you want, but ultimately the good guys are going to win. So fuck all of these people. And it's reminded me, I was watching last night by the way, before I say that, a federal judge ruled also today that gays are protected by sex discrimination laws. So that means that, for example, you can't discriminate against someone based on biological sex, but also includes protections, including a person's biological sex, but also the cultural and social aspects associated with masculinity and femininity. So you can't discriminate against someone because they're effeminate or too masculine. A woman's too masculine or too dykish, bull dykish, whatever, or a guy is too effeminate or too fey or too queer. we're looking. You can't discriminate against someone based on their sexual orientation, and you can't discriminate against someone based on their sex. So that's great, and a great step in the right direction as well. Unfortunately, that's something that's going to do well as well. Oh, wait. Oh, Caleb's in the chat room. Caleb says, Governor already signed the bill. It takes effect on July the 1st. Thank you, Caleb. Caleb lives in Mississippi, I think, don't you? Or is Alabama? I can't remember. Anyway, somewhere in those horrible states. He lives down there, and he should know. So he's saying the governor's already signed the bill. It takes effect on the 1st. So the sad thing is it's actually going to be a law there, but it's not going to happen. It's not going to stay there forever. The ACLU is going to continue to oppose the bill, and it's going to be eventually overturned. So it's just a matter of time, Caleb. I'm sure of it. There's no doubt in my mind. I'm sorry that those people in Mississippi have to endure this, in Alabama as well. Hopefully not, but hopefully in Alabama won't follow suit, but we'll see. Anyway, before I go, one more thing I wanted to talk about was I watched the movie or documentary about Loving versus Virginia, which is pertinent to what we're talking about tonight on this topic. It was on Netflix or something. I watched on HBO Go or something last night. But I knew about the case already. I talked about it on the show. I talked about it before when I talked about interracial marriage and stuff on the show. But the documentary actually was awesome because it showed actual live footage of these people going through this case. And if you don't know what Loving versus Virginia was, it was a case in which a man and a woman, Mr. and Mrs. Loving, the man was Caucasian and the woman is half Black and half Native American. And they were married. They got married. They went out of the state to get married in Washington, D.C., and then came home to get married. And apparently in Virginia at the time, it was illegal for you to go to another state to get married and come back and live there. And it was also illegal for you to get married if you were an interracial couple. So they, were jailed and harassed by their local city government and police department and thrown in jail, and the judge threw them in jail for a year. Fortunately, their sentences were suspended and they only served like a week or two in jail, but they weren't allowed to live together and they weren't allowed to come back into the state together. They could only come to the state separately, and they had to leave the state for 25 years or something like that. And so she wrote to the Attorney General of the United States of America, who at the time was Robert Kennedy, and he referred her to the right person and got her in touch with the ACLU, and the ACLU took their case and decided that it was wrong for them to not be able to marry whomever they wanted to be, and for the federal government to tell someone whom they could and could not marry was wrong and against their civil liberties. So they took up the case, and so this documentary follows from that point all the way up until the case ends, and you get to see them, meet them and their children and everything else, and it's just very interesting. And it's very sad because what happened is Mrs. Loving and Mr. Loving had to live outside of the state and for a long time. And they were used to living in the country. They're both from the country and used to lots of land and space and big houses and rooms and things like that. And they had to move to Washington, D.C., where they lived in the city, and it was tiny and the kids didn't have any room to play and it was horrible and squalor and everything else. So they wanted to move back to Virginia, where they had land they owned that they were going to build a house on. And they had a house that they were leasing or renting at the time or something. And they couldn't go back to build on their land until this was resolved. So they fought it and fought it and fought it. And finally, it went up to the Supreme Court, and these two attorneys who took their case for free fought their case and actually ended up winning. And that took down all the laws throughout the United States of America. There were 15, 16 states at the time that outlawed interracial marriages. And from just that one particular case, that point, it actually removed those laws from the books from all those other states. I mean, it made it illegal to discriminate essentially in all the states immediately. And all the states took it off their books officially, even though it was already a law, except Alabama. Alabama was the very last state to take it off of the books until 2000. And in 2000, they took it off the books, even though it was still already illegal. It was horrible. And so it doesn't surprise me at all. Anyway, so it was a very good documentary. If you haven't seen it, you might want to watch it. If you have HBO Go or HBO, you catch it on HBO. Or if you have, my fucking phone keeps going off. It's driving me crazy. Sorry. HBO Go, or you have Netflix or something, you might check it out because it's a really good good documentary, worth seeing. And just, you know, at the end, and sadly, they win. They end up moving back to Virginia. Her husband builds her the house. They live in the house for 4 or 5 years, and then they're out and about, and her husband gets killed in a car accident, and she ends up living by herself the rest of her life. But anyway, my point is that that case is a landmark case for obvious reasons, and that case applies to we gay people these days as well. And that is exactly why once DOMA, the other side of DOMA, is overturned, which is going up to be ruled on this coming year, the Supreme Court, the other side of DOMA is ruled on, it will be the same effect. All states that currently prohibit gay marriage will then have to recognize gay marriage in the same way they recognize heterosexual marriage, regardless of what their state laws say. So it's just a matter of time, and fortunately we're all going to be one big happy gay family eventually, but just got to be patient. And one more thing I want to talk about real quickly was Anderson Cooper. He actually, if you don't know who he is, I mean, you know who he is, Anderson Cooper, but if you didn't know that he was actually the son of Gloria Vanderbilt, he's the son of Gloria Vanderbilt, his mother. And his mother, of course, was from a very wealthy family, and the Vanderbilt family, the Vanderbilts, okay, that legacy. And so she's worth over $200 million that she's inherited. And also, you know, and earned a little bit, but not much. And, so she told her son, he told his mother he didn't want any of the money, $200 million, because, and she said she wasn't giving it to him anyway, because neither one of them believe in inheritance. And they think it makes you lazy and makes you complacent and not really part of society. And I think I have to agree with that. I think if I were him, and, you know, not making $11 million a year like he's making, he makes $11 million a year just for doing one thing, just the CNN job, 360. Anderson Cooper 360. So if I were not making $11 million a year and my mother were going to die and she was going to leave $200 million to somebody else, I would be pissed. I would be all for the inheritance thing. And my mother would give me the money for sure anyway, because that's how my mom is. But I understand, I guess, if you're from a wealthy family and the family constantly passes down wealth and stuff like that. Oh, he also said it was cursed, and people who inherited money were cursed and ended up having horrible lives, etc. But I don't know. I think for $200 million, I would take the risk. I think I would be okay with that. I'm not sure that I would really have a problem with it, but that's just me. Okay, so that's all I have to say tonight on the show. That's my brain purge for tonight. I just wanted to do a quick show real quick. I will be back on, what is today? This is Friday, so I'll be back on Sunday with Gay Mass. And I'm working on a big interview that I've been working on for a while. I'm trying to get someone's schedule in order, that someone that everybody knows, everybody would know this celebrity, and, would be an awesome, interview to have. So if you are interested, be sure to check me out on, Sunday's show, and I'll let you know the status of that. Otherwise, be sure to check me out on offlimitsshow.com, on twitter.com, spreaker.com, facebook.com, and also, of course, on iTunes. And I'll be back then. Thanks for listening, everybody. Thanks, Caleb. Talk to you later. Bye.